became the way and the door that leads us to the Father. Grant us your grace and mercy, and accept the fragrance of our incense, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, forever.
Speak, knowing that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and place us with you in his presence. Everything indeed is for you, so that the grace bestowed in abundance on more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow for the glory of God.
Praise be to God always.
Many people, that's kind of poetic. It's nice. It's like,
It's nicer than just Rotary Club. We'll call our club the Body of Christ. But that's not its meaning at all, of course. Body of Christ really has the aspect that there is a life, a singular life, which flows throughout a visible reality that can be identified as being Christ himself, generation after generation, throughout nations, etc. But it also means that as members of Christ, we are conduits for that life. If you take a person's body and amputate a hand, that hand will die. It will be dead. It will no longer have life. And that hand will no longer transmit the rest of life to the fingers. And the fingers will die by its removal at the wrists. And so it is also with the question of the members of Christ. Life is meant to flow from us to others. This is ultimately the epiphany, the manifestation of Christ. It's the life which flows in contact from person to person. It's not something which takes place, as we've mentioned, through bulletins or through websites or any other thing. It comes by the contact of one person who is enlivened by Christ coming into another one's contact, and that life is transmitted. So it means that for us who claim through our baptism and faith to be living members of Christ, that our lives are meant to show that Christic, that Christ aspect of a life which is grounded in grace, which is being healed, because we are never fully healed in this life. We constantly need to increase in the life of grace. But in that reintegration of healing, that we become a source of communication of that life of Christ to others. It's that phrase which I mentioned to you from the Fathers, that we take care of oneself and then help five or six along the way. This aspect is what we see in this very first chapter of St. John. And I highly encourage you, as always, read the whole Gospel today, which is part of chapter 1 of St. John. You don't read the whole Gospel of St. John, but just go in your scriptures and find the beginning of St. John and read this Gospel. One of the things that stands out in the Gospel of St. John, as we've mentioned before, is that he's not telling the story of our Lord's ministry like the other evangelists. The other evangelists are essentially the same, almost even down to details of the event. St. John is coming to explain what those events mean. He's writing decades after the other Gospels, and he's giving an explanation. So what is fascinating about this is the epiphany and the great influence of the Gospel of St. John upon the Syriac tradition. When St. John comes in the beginning of it, this is the very first chapter, it's the beginning of his Gospel, he doesn't talk about our Lord being baptized. He talks about the events of the people around this event. So he doesn't talk about the actual baptism, our Lord going down to the waters, the heavens opening out, the voice of the Father, the appearance of the Spirit over our Lord. He doesn't discuss those things as they have already been discussed, and you know them because you are members of the baptized body of Christ. So what St. John is doing decades later is explaining what happens to the people around this event. And this Gospel today may sound similar to last week, because we have, "Behold the Lamb of God." We had that last week too. Because in fact, it's mentioned twice in this first chapter. Two successive days. We have the baptism of our Lord. St. John gives us the vision of the Word, the divinity of the Word, and the Word was made flesh, and he made his dwelling, he tabernacled himself among us. He pitched his tent, quite literally is what the term says. Then we have the testimony of John the Baptist. That was last week. And he gives the reason why he's pointing out this man from Nazareth as being the Lamb of God, and how he had been given testimony by God himself that the one upon whom he would see the Spirit rest would be the Messiah, the promised one. That's last week. Then we're told the following day, he sees our Lord passing by, And he says again, look, behold, this is the Lamb of God. Now this has significance for anyone in Israel, because the Lamb of God is the Paschal Lamb. It's the Lamb which is sacrificed on the night during the plagues of Egypt, of the killing of the firstborn. And the moving from slavery and bondage of Egypt to the adoration and the covenant of Mount Sinai. So St. John's phrase to these young men who are with him, and we're told there's two of them. They are Andrew and John. We know it's John because John very significantly never mentions his name. So we almost always are certain that at the point where he mentions just another disciple or someone else, then it's him. Because he also gives us the detail later on that it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon. So he's there. And what happens is when he points out the Lamb of God, this to every Israelite means exodus, covenant, newness, renewal, salvation, redemption from bondage. And he doesn't tell the two young men, go after him. But we're told they hear John, his testimony that he had given the day before, but how he knows this is the Messiah. And at the same time announces it again today to the two of them. So they simply go off and follow our Lord. And it's a lovely little detail because our Lord notices them coming behind him. And he turns to them and he asks them, what are you looking for? We could have begun the sermon with that. What are you seeking? Why are we alive? What is our life supposed to mean? Does it have purpose? Does it have value? Or do we, as I say so often, just bob along, pay our bills, and then croak? Is that what life is really meant to be? Or is there a value in each and every one of us why God created us? There is a reality on this personal level that every single human being who is created is a unique reflection of the infinite perfection of God. That cannot be repeated. That will never be repeated. And in that fundamental value, what do we do with that personal existence? And so in the reality that takes place here, when John follows and Andrew follow after him, again, these are 20-somethings, these are young guys, following this rabbi who's only 30 himself, he asked them, what are you looking for? Why have you been down here at this river with John in the Jordan? Why have you left your families in Bethsaida? Why have you come down here? What are you looking for? That's something that each of us personally have to resolve in our lives. What does my personal life mean? And does it have a purpose? And that's why the response from Andrew and John is rabbi, teacher. St. John explains that rabbi means teacher. It literally means my great one. Rabbo in Syriac is great. Rabbi, my great one. The one who is more learned, therefore, to teach me. They are asking to be instructed. This is not celebrity. This is not go meet the Messiah and then you can tell everyone and take a selfie and say you've met the Messiah. They are looking for instruction. Illuminate our minds. Teach us, Rabbi. And it's not just in passing, we know, because they say, where are you staying? Take us there. Spend time with us. Teach us. And so I began the sermon by using that term. Rabbi, where are you staying? Where can I go to find and have my mind illuminated and to come to know? Now, that's one aspect of us personally that we see in the gospel. The purpose of my life, the value of my life, and how it is meant to be transformed in grace. But the second thing is responsibility. That when we receive grace, it's not just for us. This is meant to be a life. And life is meant to propagate and move and give animation and continue to spread. A rock's just a rock. A rock just stays there. But life grows and develops and reproduces. And that responsibility is the answer to the grace given by this rabbi of Nazareth. Responsibility, as we mentioned, comes from the Latin word respondere. It means to answer, our word response. So responsibility means the ability to give an answer for something. So when we're in charge of an office, we're responsible for the good running of the office. When we receive grace and healing and redemption and this charity of God, there is a responsibility that this life does not die here. That this life is transmitted also to others. And that is a very serious responsibility. God does not give us life of the divinity so that it be snuffed out after me. I am meant to be that channel of grace. So on one hand, it is a tremendous gift that we are given life and grace. But we are also given a responsibility that others also come to live. And that is why we're immediately told Andrew is the brother of Simon Peter, and then we're told how Simon Peter comes about. Because Andrew goes back north. He finds Simon. He finds his older brother, and he says, "We have found the Messiah. So come and see him, meet him. We met him, we know him." Of course, Simon is not his younger brother. He's already run off from fishing, leaving us behind to do all of our work, my father and me. But he goes with him. And then, of course, our Lord, what we have this week commemorating the second week of the Epiphany is the spreading, the Epiphany, the manifestation of this life of the divine word to the apostles. But it's from person to person. Andrew finds his brother, he brings Simon, our Lord meets Simon, and he says, "You are Simon Johnson, Simon son of John. But from now on we're going to call you Kepha, we're going to call you Rock." This is the first meeting. And then as the gospel will go on that you will read, they talk about then they go to Philip, somebody else's friend, in the same village, and they bring Philip into this. So now we have John, and we have Andrew, and we have Simon, and we have Philip. And Philip knows someone called Nathanael. Nathanael lives in another village called Cana. And they bring Nathanael in. And Nathanael goes to meet our Lord. Life being given, member of Christ, responsibility, life being transmitted. So that when Cana Sunday comes in 4 more weeks, the beginning of the great fast. How fast it moves from Christmas. When they arrive at Cana for the changing of the water and the wine, this great marriage feast, there are 5 men with our Lord, and of course, his mom. Those are the disciples from person to person that this life is transmitted. So what we are to finish with today then, in a practical level, we mentioned to you last week, it's why the church is mine, is that we always be present at the mysteries week after week. Not because of what God gets out of it, but because of what we get out of it, this contact. Rabbi, where are you staying? Where do I find you to be in contact with you so that I might live, and in living I may transmit life to others? So obviously the divine mysteries are the way that we find the Rabbi of Nazareth. That life and grace transform us, that our minds be illuminated, and that our souls be transformed. I came across a statistic just the other day, in fact yesterday, in which when you do the statistics in the census of the Catholic population of the United States, you come to a very minimal number of about 15%. Of course, these are all self-identified Catholics. If you don't consider yourself a Catholic, you don't fill in the response that way. So of the self-identified Catholics, if you go through a checklist of what the Catholic faith really is, statistically at this time, only about 15% of those self-identified Catholics actually believe the whole Catholic creed, catechism. We abort as much as the rest of non-Catholic America aborts. We divorce as much as non-Catholic America divorces. And this is tragic. Something has gone off the rails here. Rabbi, where are you staying? Is the desire that we be taught, that our minds be illuminated. And so our desire is to stay with our Lord so that that life be precisely a light in our lives. Through the divine mysteries, and because we're not always at the mysteries, it's the reason why our daily prayers are so important. God communicates his grace through the divine mysteries, through the blessings and the ceremonies of the church, of course, the body of Christ, but also through prayer. So if we're not at the mysteries, and we're not praying, we are essentially deaf to the blessings of God. That is very sad. The other statistic we had is that 25% of self-identified Catholics believe in reincarnation, which in fact is not just simply a bizarre idea, it's a heresy condemned in the 4th century. So let us, who have braved the cold today, and who have been able to escape from the humidity of Florida, let us come and ask our Lord Rabbi, where are you staying? Give us the strength and the love to participate in your divine mysteries, and give us the love of prayer that on a daily basis we may stay with you, and you may give us life, and in living we may transmit this to others through your grace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We believe in one God, Father.
Lord.
accept these offerings that your children have brought to you out of their love for you and for your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life and your kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, Saints Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint Charbel. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers, and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom the sacrifice is offered, for the intentions of all the members of this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Pardon us and have mercy upon your inheritance. For this you repent in church and towards you and through you and with you, in God your Father's sake.
Thank you.
prayers and answer petitions. You taught us through your beloved Son to stand before you, to call upon you with pure souls and with clear consciences, praying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Deliver us, O Lord, from every temptation and from harm of evil. For you have power over all, and we raise glory to you, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving offering, and before the body and blood of our Savior, whose life to those who partake of it, and receive the blessing from the Lord.
O Lord, in your grace and abundant mercy, bless those who bow before you. Make us worthy to share in your life-giving mysteries, and to join the assembly of your saints, that with them we may raise glory to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirits.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility, and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, perfection, purity, and sanctity. One Holy Father,
one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, and it is the one that had on earth, to him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God,
so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body,
and our souls purified by your forgiving blood.
May our community be
Mother of
Gracious God and Father, how can we repay you for your goodness and the salvation you have just given us? Who can give you the glory you truly deserve? In our weakness, and insofar as we are able, we worship, praise, and thank you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you. Jesus Christ, our God, we worship, thank, and praise you. We implore your goodness and abundant mercy for the salvation of the whole world, for the protection of the living and eternal rest to the departed, for the feeding of the hungry and the support of the needy, for the visiting of the sick and the consolation of the grieving. Through your grace, dwell in them, and by your abundant mercy, give them life. By your cross, bless your people and protect your inheritance. Adoration is due to you, to your Father, and to your Holy and Mighty-Giving Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.